That'll be our first text for the day. We've had a lot of prayer this morning. Some men stood in front of us, led us in prayer. And maybe they said something like, I think Tom said, Holy Father in heaven, or Holy God, our Father in heaven. And I don't know what you did. Maybe you bowed your head. Maybe you closed your eyes. Maybe you had a kid you had to make sure it didn't sneak down the pew. I don't know. But we all gathered together in prayer, and each of those prayers were prayed in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And if you prayed when they prayed, you may be sitting in a pew, in a building, in small town Oklahoma, but that is not the entire reality of what happened. Because if when they prayed, you prayed along with them, you weren't just sitting here in a building. You were in the throne room of God. It wasn't just words spoken. It wasn't just heads bowed. We entered into God's throne room. Picture that in your head. Picture what you think a throne room looks like. To me, I kind of, because I watched every King Arthur movie that they made when I was a kid, I have a pretty good picture of what a throne room is. Noble people standing at attention. The king sitting on his throne, and all royalty is his, and all honor and glory is given to him. When we bowed and prayed, suddenly we weren't just here, we were in the presence of God himself. When you pray, do you think in that way? When you pray, when you're at home, when you're in your car, wherever you are, when you pray, you're entering into the august, majestic presence of the Creator of all things and the Redeemer of our souls. Go to Hebrews 4. Let's look at verse 14 there. Let's walk back through that. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. First thing in verse 14, it mentions that Jesus is our high priest. The job of a high priest was to intercede between people and God and to draw people nearer to God. And most of that job had to do with sacrifice, whether to atone for sin, or maybe it was an expression of absolute devotion to God, or maybe that sacrifice was just an expression of thankfulness to God for his blessings and all that he's done. But the priest's job was to be a go-between. Jesus, as our high priest, is a go-between between us who are often so sinful and flawed, and he brings us into the presence of God. But this high priest knows what we go through. He knows our weaknesses. He knows our struggles. He knows our frailties. Jesus knows what it's like to be tempted. He knows. He gets it. He felt the same desires that you and I feel. He feels those things. He understands a desire that could lead to a sinful place. The difference is where we've indulged them again and again, he never did. He was sinless, perfect. Yet even in his sinlessness and perfection, he, in a sense, abandoned that to become sin on the cross. He took the punishment that I deserve and that you deserve on himself on that cross. The perfect took the punishment that we deserved, and by his wounds we are healed. And now he intercedes for us so that when we pray, we're able to draw near to God's throne and we're able to do it with confidence. When you pray to God, sometimes you may throw yourself on your face. Sometimes you may be humbled. Sometimes you may feel terror. But the truth is, you can enter before God with confidence, not because of who you are, but because what Jesus has done for you. So when we enter, we don't enter arrogantly, but know that you belong there. Just as when you go to your mom and dad's house, I'm thinking of me. When I walk into my mom and dad's house, I don't ring the doorbell. I walk in because I belong there. When you enter into the throne room of God, you belong there. confidently bring whatever you're bringing to God. Notice it's not a throne of judgment. When you come before God, it's not God sitting on his throne ready to drop the hammer on you and looking for reasons to pick you apart. It's not a throne of judgment. It's not a throne of indifference. You don't come before God and he not really care if you're there or could care less about what you're saying. When you enter before God's throne room, it's a throne of grace, meaning God's favor, his mercy, his grace are all extended to you. You're his daughter. You're his son. He wants to hear what you have to say. He is there for you. Even though, you know, we prayed this morning and millions of people over the face of the earth were also praying this morning. But the throne room is big enough for us all, and God's attention is enough to hear every single prayer that's lifted up before. And he responds with grace and mercy. As we approach that throne, we do it with confidence, trusting that we will receive what we need from the hand of God. And in the hour of need, he will not fail to come through on your behalf. So, this whole month, all of February, every Sunday in February, in song and in scripture and in the sermon, we're going to be focused on prayer. And today we approach God in thanksgiving. Being thankful, being grateful is something that every one of us should grasp. Listen, as children of the King, we have received blessing upon blessing from the hand of our King. Not only the salvation and redemption, but the provision and the protection and the care and the nurturing and the attention, all these things have been lavished on us and showered on us. Gratitude should be our native tongue. It should pour forth from us because of all the things that God has done for us. So, right now, we're going to offer our thanks to God, and Gene is going to come up and voice that gratitude for us. And I told Gene there are no time limits, so strap in. He told me he was going to let the Spirit move him, so I don't know what he's going to say, but Gene, come on up, man.
I want to, hopefully I'm not stealing a scripture from Kevin's sermon, but I want you to turn to Hebrews 12. And as Kevin put this challenge, I guess, or this opportunity before me, this verse came to my mind. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe. Think about that. Because do we not oftentimes, when we go to God in prayer, we list our bruises? So today, I want us to focus on our blessings. So would you bow with me? To our Father in heaven, we bow before you and acknowledge you as our one true God who sent his Son. We acknowledge you as the most holy of holies. You are our sovereign Lord, and we say thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for creating us. Not just creating us, but creating us in your image. And in that image, we can find a place to be your sons and daughters. Thank you. And Heavenly Father, as we recognize being your sons and daughters, we're also human. And I think back to the time of the Garden of Eden. What a perfect place that was. But when sin came in, you never stopped pursuing the very ones you loved. Thank you. Thank you for continued that pursuit, not just then, but even now, dear Father. And as we are your sons and daughters, we do sin, but you do not stop that pursuit. So Heavenly Father, as we continue in that mindset of being your sons and daughters, you have revealed to us that we are part of an unshakable kingdom. Thank you, Father, for that gift. The kingdom that hell cannot even rattle, cannot even break through the gates. Thank you, Father, for an unshakable kingdom. Thank you for the opportunity to be in that kingdom and to offer up a sacrifice of praise, honor, awe, and reverence. And Heavenly Father, as we're part of that unshakable kingdom, you have set before us the works that need to be done. Thank you, Father, for that opportunity to serve you, to show others around us who you are. Thank you, Father, for the love that you pour into us, so that in that time of good works, we let that love flow from us. Thank you. Thank you, Father, for that love at the beginning of time, that you did not want us to live on this earth forever, but you wanted us to live with you forever. And through your Son, we have eternal life. Heavenly Father, thank you for that life. And we understand that that life is not when we die, but that life is now while we're living. Because we have an opportunity to know you. Thank you for the opportunity to know you, to understand you, because it's in your word that you have given us. Thank you for that word. And as we pursue you in your word, you're letting yourself to be known so that we may love you and serve you and know you not just as our God and as our Lord, but as our Father. Heavenly Father, because of that, we can say Abba, Father. Because of who we are, because of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, thank you for that opportunity to know you as our Father, who loves us, who desires us to be our very best. Heavenly Father, thank you for disciplining us. I know none of us want to say thank you for that, but as we look back, we realize that through that discipline, we have let go of bad habits and we have picked up the good habits. And in that discipline, we recognize your love and your care because you want us to be with you. So Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to know you from your word. And in your word, we can find your wisdom. So thank you, Father, for your wisdom, because when things are challenging for us, when we are bombarded with things of this world, with emotions that we cannot seem to grab a hold of, but Heavenly Father, through relationships here on this earth, we can find wisdom because of your love for us and because of your word, we can gain understanding on how to live and be that light, to share that hope that's within us. Thank you, Father, for that wisdom. And in that wisdom, we can know that your very presence is in us. Not just us as an individual, but us as a community of believers. Because we have a God who has said throughout time, I will never forsake you, nor will I desert you. Even in our most weakest of moments, when we are the most frightened, when we are the most anxious, you're right there by our side, lifting us up, holding us together, and guiding us through the most challenging of times so that we can be more like you on the other side of that challenge. Thank you for that wisdom that guides us, for your very presence that never leaves us. And Heavenly Father, I pray that we will always look to you. And Heavenly Father, in that presence, we have the strength to overcome. When we seem like we are the weakest, Heavenly Father, you lift us up on the wings of eagles. You help us run as horses run, Heavenly Father. And dear Father, I pray that we will always lean into that strength. And Heavenly Father, and through that strength, we become more like you day after day. And Heavenly Father, I thank you for our family. I thank you for our family that's here at South Yukon. I thank you for the families that have come together at the beginning of this congregation's lifetime. And I thank you for the families that you have brought to us just within the last 2 years. Thank you, Father, for bringing us together, knowing that we are sons and daughters of you, knowing that we're a part of an unshakable kingdom, but we are a family. And Heavenly Father, may we each look to one another and remember you are our Father. And you've given us an opportunity to love one another as family. Even when we are the most challenging towards one another, we'd never break that relationship because of you. Even when some of us may be the most difficult to live with, maybe some of us who are not understanding of one another, but because of you, we will not break that relationship. Thank you, Father, for family. Thank you, for Father. Thank you, Father, for the family that receives us as we are. And Heavenly Father, thank you that in those families and in this family, we have fellowship. And Heavenly Father, as you began on the day of Pentecost, you brought all those souls together for that one spirit, that one love, that one mindset, to be that one body because of one Lord. You have brought us together for fellowship. And Heavenly Father, thank you. Because when we seem like we're all alone, we know that we have the family to insulate us. Thank you, Father, for that time. Thank you for the fellowship of love, the fellowship of sharing when we're in need. Thank you for that fellowship of this morning as we come together to worship you, but to encourage one another. Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you are, for all that you have done, and all that you will do. And may we continue in this time of thanksgiving, not just this morning, but each day forward that we're brought together. And Heavenly Father, most of all, thank you for the renewing of our spirits today. Thank you that your mercies are new every day. Thank you that you have given us an opportunity to correct, to live, but to be like you through the power of Jesus and through the power of your Spirit. Thank you. And dear Father, may we be a time of thanksgiving, but dear Father, may be a time of thanks living. Heavenly Father, we pray this prayer because we love you so much, but we acknowledge your love towards us. And may we always have a heart of gratitude because we are a part of a family, a part of an unshakable kingdom, because we have one true God. We pray all this through your Son, Jesus Christ, and through the power of your Spirit, for you are God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen, right? And is there anything more beautiful than just people appreciating one another or appreciating their lives? I mean, thankfulness is so attractive let me flip it. Isn't ingratitude really repugnant? Over the years, I've seen people who've had parents who blessed them and took care of them and looked after them. Is this thing on? Nope. I'm backing up over here then. I guess because I turned it off. I've seen people over the years who've had parents that bless them and take care of them and look after them and provide for them, and then they just turn their backs on their parents when they get older. You know, I've seen that kind of thing. It's just ugly. I've seen other people
who have people go out of their way to lift them up or do right by them, and then just the ingratitude kicks in. It's an ugly thing. Turn to Numbers 11 real quick. Gene, I appreciate that prayer so much. Beautiful. Just nurturing nourishment for our souls. Numbers 11. Here's the situation. The Israelites had been delivered from slavery. I mean, God stepped into their horrible situation and with amazing power delivered them from bondage. And he took them from a place where they were mistreated, where they, what they worked for, they didn't get to benefit from it, where apparently on occasion their babies were killed by their slave masters. And God brings them out of that. And he's trying to bring them to a place that is beautiful and glorious, where they'll be provided for, this land of milk and honey. But in between Egypt and Canaan, it seemed all they did was complain and complain. They were ungrateful for what they received. God literally gave them manna from heaven, the bread of angels to eat. He miraculously provided food, but nothing was ever good enough for them. Look in verse 4 here. Now the rabble, I like that, she calls them rabble. The rabble that was among them had a strong craving. And the people of Israel also wept again and said, "Oh, that we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt that cost nothing. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up and there's nothing at all but this manna to look at." Isn't that crazy? These people are out in the middle of nowhere. God is showering miraculous food on them from heaven, and they don't want it. And it's just temporary. It's just till they get from point A to B. But all they can do is reminisce and wax nostalgic about how great slavery was in Egypt. Look at all the fish we ate for free. Isn't that insane? It wasn't for free. They were slaves to get that food. And yet all they could do was show ungratefulness toward God. What happened to them? They died in the desert. Every one of them, they died in the desert because of their ungrateful hearts. In Romans 1, I won't read this section, but in Romans 1, I just want to encourage you to read Romans 1. Go home and read it. And I'm afraid you're going to see our world in it right there. But one of the things that God condemns them for is just their lack of thankfulness. They're unthankful. God condemned them for it. There is no upside to living with ingratitude, and there is nothing but upside to live with thankfulness. When we live the way God designed us to live, we find that blessed and abundant life. I'm just going to read you a list. These are studies. This is not biblical. These are secular studies that have come up with everything I'm about to read you. There are emotional benefits to living with gratitude. We're happier. Our psychological well-being is healthier. Our positive emotions are even more positive. So our bottom isn't as low and our high is even higher. It enhances our positive emotions, but also increases our self-esteem. It keeps suicidal thoughts at bay. Got word this week that a guy that I knew, used to do church camps with, my age, wife and kids at home, ended his life. Living a life of gratitude, studies have shown, combat that. If you have suicidal ideation, intentionally being grateful fights against that. Those are emotional benefits. They're social benefits. People like you better if you're grateful. That's just the truth. Because if you're a bitter pill that only focuses on the negative, you're pushing people out of your life. It improves our romantic relationships. It improves our friendships. It increases our social support. Because we're grateful for what we've been given and everything is stronger because of that. It strengthens our family relationships in times of stress. So that if your family is used to getting from you gratefulness, thankfulness, when things go bad, they're going to come together for you quicker and better. There are personality benefits. You're more optimistic, more giving. You're less materialistic because you're not so scared, because you're not operating in the impression that I'm not getting enough. When you realize I have more than enough, then you're more generous in your heart to give to other people. There are physical health benefits. If you struggle with depression, blood pressure, high blood pressure, if you can't sleep, it improves every bit of that. All of those things are improved just on a physical level. When it comes to recovery from addiction, substance abuse, depression, living with gratitude and intentionally focusing on the things you're thankful for elevates those things and helps bring you out of those things, gives you strength to combat them. So this week, I want to ask you to deliberately focus on gratitude. And I'm going to give you a list of ways you can do it. Number one, if you're a talker, have conversations about it. Talk about the things you're thankful with, thankful for with the people you're close to. Just have a conversation. Strike it up. Man, I'm grateful for, I don't know, running water. I know that sounds silly, but I've lived in places where there was no hot water. I've thanked God for hot water as much as anything else in my life, I think. Thank God for your family. Let them know about it. So have conversations. If you're a writer, a journalist, if you journal, spend 10 or 15 minutes a day just journaling what you're thankful for and see what effect it has on you just at the end of 1 week. There are a lot of artists here. Maybe express gratitude through art. I don't know, Bob, you're a painter. How do you paint gratitude? I don't know. I'd like to see you make a run at it, but we have songwriters here. We have a number of songwriters here. Maybe write a song about it. We have authors here, published authors. Maybe write something to express that gratitude. You could do something as simple as just counting your blessings. And I mean making a list of everything that you feel you're blessed about. Reach out to people for whom you're grateful. Let them know about it. Don't let them just go by without you expressing that gratitude. Let them know. Find new ways to express how thankful you are and grateful to God this week. Don't let this week be wasted. Let your thankfulness be shown. And then let's live by the words of Colossians 15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Since as members of one body, you are called to peace and be thankful. I want to offer an invitation right now. Pretty simple. It's just an opportunity to express your gratitude. If you want to express your gratitude in any way towards God, in any way, please come forward while we stand and sing.